you all for a discussion on the book, Indian Cultural Diplomacy, Celebrating Pluralism in a Globalized World, an ICWA publication authored by Ambassador Paramjit Sahay. Allow me to brief you all about today's program. The program would begin with introductory remarks from DG ICWA, Dr. T.C.A. Raghavan, followed by opening remarks by the Chair, Ambassador Lalit Mansingh, former Foreign Secretary of India and Chairman, Kalinga International Foundation. Thereafter, Ambassador Paramjit Sahay would share his thoughts about the book, which would be followed by the book discussion, chaired by Ambassador Lalit Mansingh. Our esteemed panelists for the discussion are Shri Suresh K. Goel, former DG, Indian Council for Cultural Relations, Shri Tarun Vijay, former Member of Parliament, who will be joining us in a short while, Shri Akhilesh Mishra, DG Indian Council for Cultural Relations. May I request all the panelists to kindly grace the dais. This discussion shall be followed by Q&A session and closing remarks by the chair. May I now request Director General ICWA, Dr. T.C.A. Raghavan, to deliver his introductory remarks.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, very good afternoon to all of you. It's a great pleasure to have you all with us this afternoon for the launch of this, our latest publication, Indian Cultural Diplomacy by Mr. Paramjit Sahay. Now, the book is wonderful in many ways. What struck me most was in the beginning, Mr. Sahay talking about his own encounter with cultural diplomacy. And it begins with his landing in Moscow in early 1964. And encountering the very well-known at that time Bollywood song "Mera Juta Hai Japani," and the book ends with his during a time when he was High Commissioner in Malaysia, when he encountered another Bollywood song, which is "Kuch Kuch Hota Hai," and I'd like to read out very briefly what he says about this journey from "Mera Juta Hai Japani" to "Kuch Kuch Hota Hai," and I quote, "Bollywood does connect, but cultural diplomacy is beyond Bollywood. It is not kuch kuch, but sab kuch, about promoting understanding with everyone. Cultural diplomacy is at the heart of diplomacy. How does it connect with soft power and public diplomacy with which it is interchangeably used? Let me whet your appetite to learn more about cultural diplomacy, and you will find some answers as you wade through the pages of this book. We need more connectivity bridges than strategic partnerships as we seek dialogue through the medium of cultural diplomacy." Mr. Sahay has worked very hard. This book has a great deal of very, very interesting historical information from the times of our very first cultural cooperation agreement and so on. It's also a great privilege to have with us today two former Director Generals of the Indian Council of World Affairs, Mr. Rajiv Bhatia, who commissioned the book, Mr. Nalin Suri, who saw the book through till the last stages, and therefore their presence here is a matter of great pride and pleasure for all of us, and I'm sure for Mr. Sahay too. We are also very fortunate to have with us another former Director General, Mr. Devre, who in his own way and at different times has played such a critical role in the field of cultural diplomacy as far as India is concerned. I don't wish to speak at great length because I don't want to, I couldn't possibly anticipate what the panel is going to say, but the panel itself is a very distinguished grouping. We have, of course, Ambassador Lalit Mansingh. For many of us, I remember my when I joined service, one of the first things we learned about cultural diplomacy was from him. We have the serving Director General of the Indian Council of Cultural Relations, a former Mr. Akhilesh Mishra. We have Shri Goel with us, who's a former Director General of the Indian Council of Cultural Relations. I hope Mr. Tarun Vijay is able to join us soon, but in any event, we have a very formidable panel to discuss this very important and wonderful book on Indian cultural diplomacy. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your presence here today. Thank you.
May I now request Ambassador Lalit Mansingh to give his opening remarks and conduct the proceedings.
Ambassador Raghavan, Ambassador Sahai, Ambassador Goel, Ambassador Akhilesh Mishra, many other distinguished excellencies in the audience, many distinguished spouses, members of the media, academia. I think it's a very impressive gathering for a very good cause. First of all, let me extend my warmest felicitations to Akhilesh for taking over as DG of the ICCR. I'm sure you'll enjoy it, as many of us ex-DGs have enjoyed it, and best of luck to you. I also want to specially mention and welcome Mrs. Sahai. Nina has been properly acknowledged in the book, and even her complaints against her husband have also been recorded. Thank you, and thank all the spouses who have suffered us during our career and afterwards. The Indian Foreign Service is a very cultural gifted community. Even though it is small in numbers, we have amongst us writers, scholars, authors, poets, even classical musicians. And therefore, it is not surprising that culture is such a live issue in the Foreign Service community. We also have a number of former DGs of the ICCR, many who have adorned the post and contributed much to cultural diplomacy. So we are actually looking forward to a very good discussion. Well, before I speak about the subject, let me also add that we are passing through very good days for cultural diplomacy. I must say that the Prime Minister has brought in a lot of dynamism into foreign policy. But wherever he has gone, he has made special mention of India's cultural heritage. And therefore, it has added an extra dimension to our foreign policy. But let me start with a disclosure. Ambassador Sahai and I are batchmates. And we have known each other for more than 55 years. So my disclosure is that I will not even pretend to be objective. I will be pretty heavily biased in whatever I say about him. But let me also try to be as balanced as possible. Having said that, the fact that you have known a person for 55 years doesn't mean that you know him well. And Ambassador Sahai sprang a surprise on me when he declared that he was going to write a book on cultural policy. He didn't seem to me a man who was terribly excited about culture or was even enthusiastic about cultural policy, but there you are. It was actually a surprise, but as we discussed the subject and we went along, I found that his commitment was actually very genuine and he was pretty passionate about the subject. Culture is a very difficult subject, and it's a very foolish person who would like to speak with authority on culture. Many of us have been only on the periphery, and we know it's a very deep ocean. But Indians generally carry their 5,000-year-old culture on their shoulders and talk endlessly about culture. I have a suspicion that the more you talk, the less you know about it. So we have to be aware that our religious and cultural diversity, our different languages, our cultural practices are pretty difficult to comprehend and put together. To write on cultural diplomacy, therefore, you have to be a very brave person, like my friend is, I'm sure. Well, if Ambassador Sahay surprised me with his desire to write a book and with his cultural evangelism, the book itself has turned my surprise into admiration. For the first time, a comprehensive, authoritative, and informative account of Indian cultural diplomacy has been attempted. And therefore, for this achievement alone, please accept my warmest felicitations. On a lighter note, I think this will set at rest forever all the Sardarji jokes about Punjabis not having culture and the culture of Punjab being agriculture. to have a Sardar who's now the authority on cultural diplomacy will dispel all these doubts. I noticed that the non-Sardars are clapping a lot. For a pioneering effort, I think this is quite an amazing work of scholarship. It defines the concept of cultural diplomacy. It explains the differences with soft power, with which it is often confused, and then proceeds to give his views on what should cultural diplomacy be in the context of globalization. And he has also brought in a lot of fresh elements which have entered into cultural diplomacy, like sports, yoga, Ayurveda, and diaspora issues, which need to be integrated into the wider framework of cultural diplomacy. The book is a virtual encyclopedia. In fact, if I were to give it an alternative title, I would say it should be called All You Wanted to Know About Culture and Diplomacy. Now, I don't want to anticipate what Ambassador Sahay has to say about the book and the kind of structure that he has worked on. And I also am keenly looking forward to what our distinguished panelists are going to say. But I'm going to raise a few issues that crossed my mind when I went through the book. And let me give priority to three of these thoughts. One is, how valid are the assumptions of our policy on cultural diplomacy? The second is the MEA fulfilling its role as the nodal agency for cultural diplomacy? And the third is, does ICCR need to reinvent itself to suit the needs of 21st century India? Let's start with the policy on cultural diplomacy. Ambassador Sahay views it as a kind of connectivity bridge whose goal is to promote understanding amongst nations through the ideals of India. For him, the idea of India, he puts it in quotes, is based on Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. And India, according to him, should proceed to win the hearts and minds of people all over the world by promoting the ideals of India. In fact, he endorses the fact that India should become the Vishwa Guru. In the author's analysis, the importance of politics has diminished in diplomacy in the post-Cold War era and has given way to economics. And he thinks that the future of diplomacy lies in cultural diplomacy, which he regards as the foundation of the diplomacy of the future. Well, I have my own views, slightly different from what he has defined, but I'll be happy to go along with it broadly. But let me give the following thoughts for your consideration. Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Now, and the concept of the Vishwaguru. It's a fact that the original shloka, which includes Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, does not speak about a global family. It is a shloka which defines high intellect and low intellect. Ayam nija paro beti ganala laghu chetasam udara charita namchu vasudhaiva kutumbakam. If you are of low intellect, you'll say, this is mine, that is yours. If you have a broader intellect, well, the world is like a family. We should all share it. Okay. Now, if this is the shloka we are following, I have a problem about how to promote this ideal abroad. If we believe in the global family, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, then surely we should also have to prove that we in India are also a family, that Indians are a family if you want to make Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam credible. My second point is the concept of the Vishwa Guru, I think, needs to be moderated. I think it would be better if countries come to us and regard us as a guru than for us to proclaim it that we are your guru, come to us for wisdom. And therefore, there should be a little bit of humility on the part of the guru to say, well, we came up with a lot of good ideas, but we are also open to new ideas from other sources. And therefore, my other observation is cultural diplomacy has to be a two-way street. There is much that India can learn from other countries. And here, I'm not referring to what the big powers do in terms of the Alliance Française, the Max Müller Bhavan, or the Smithsonian, or the British Council. I am referring to a lot of small countries which have had contacts with India in the past and have completely disappeared from our radar. To these countries, for us to say we are Vishwaguru, I think we are doing them a disservice. Think of the fact that India had a dominant role in the spread of ideas in the Indo-Pacific region, particularly in Southeast Asia. You go to Bangkok airport, you're greeted with an installation of Samudra Manthan. You go to Malaysia, there's a giant statue of Lord Murugan outside, in front of a mountain, where there are caves which are temples dedicated to Lord Shiva. I recently visited Cambodia, where I went to the sacred Kulen Mountain, where on a river that emerges from that mountain, there are 1,000 Shiva lingas carved out on the riverbed. You go to the stunning temples of Angkor Wat and Angkor Thom and Bante Sri, and you see how much of Indian culture is stored there. You go to Indonesia and see Borobudur, the greatest temple ever built for Buddhism. And near that temple, not very far away, are three stunning temples in a row, one dedicated to Brahma, the other to Vishnu, the other to Shiva. The Indonesians, Indonesia being the largest Muslim country in the world, still treasures its pre-Islamic heritage in the form of the Ramayana and Mahabharata. Are we acknowledging the role that these countries have played in promoting and developing further the cultural heritage of India? I don't think so. I think we have been a little insensitive in claiming that whatever they have is borrowed from us. Actually, my own experience is, in many ways, they have evolved art, architecture, and the fine arts into a much higher level than we developed in India. Are Indians interested in seeing these treasures which are in our neighborhood? I don't know. You know, there are about 60,000 tourists who go out of India every year, and only a few thousand who visit Cambodia and the countries around it. A few thousand. This is not a measure of how we treasure our own values which other countries have preserved. Cambodia alone, I learned, had 2.2 million tourists, small country like Cambodia. And they say in 5 years' time, they'll have 5 million Chinese tourists there. We still have a few thousand going there. I think I've made my point. The time, as I said, has come for the Vishwaguru to show a little sensitivity and a little humility. A further final comment. We have been talking a lot about the importance of Buddhism. And I know that the Prime Minister, in all his trips in the Indo-Pacific region, has highlighted not only the cultural links, but particularly the ancient links we've had with Buddhism. Ambassador Sahai, in his book, traces Indian cultural diplomacy to the 3rd century BC, when Emperor Ashoka promoted Buddhism through missionaries sent to the entire Indo-Pacific region. But there's a sobering thought I have. If we care so much about Buddhism, how come we haven't done much for the two nations that actually preserved Buddhism for India when it was driven out of our country? And these two nations are Tibet and Sri Lanka. These two nations have preserved the Buddhist traditions. The Tibetans have preserved the Mahayana tradition, and the Sri Lankans have preserved the Theravada tradition. I hear a lot about Buddhism. I don't see much action on Buddhism or see Buddhism as a very active part of our cultural diplomacy. There was a wonderful initiative taken by the Government of India a few years ago, and this was an institution called the International Buddhist Confederation. It was an impressive organization. When they had meetings every year, it drew Buddhist delegations from something like 45 countries from abroad. It was amazing. But guess what? A splendid initiative has been allowed to collapse. And the reason is that divisions within the government finally led to the intelligence agencies taking ownership of this, and the project has collapsed. Okay. Now let me turn to the role of the MEA. And let me try to correct a misperception that has inadvertently crept into the book, which is that the MEA has always been the chosen instrument of cultural diplomacy. That role, in my view, originally belonged to the Department of Education. When the ICCR was formed in 1950, it was firmly planted in the Ministry of Education. Its founder, or the two founders of the ICCR, Prime Minister Nehru and Maulana Azad, felt that it was logical that the ICCR should be under the control of the Department of Education. So, education ministers from independence onwards, from Maulana Azad to Professor Nurul Hasan, were the presidents of the ICCR, and the ICCR functioned under their jurisdiction. I remember on one of my trips to Moscow, when Professor Nurul Hasan was the ambassador, in a fit of anger, he told me, "I made the greatest mistake in my life. I've allowed the ICCR to go to MEA." Well, is MEA the ideal ministry for the ICCR? Now, I know I take the risk of being lynched in this large group of former colleagues, but let me say with candor, and you'll forgive me for this, that in the mainstream of the IFS and within the MEA, culture does not have a high priority. In fact, when I joined the service many, many years ago, along with my distinguished batchmate Mani Iyer, who is sitting here, and many others who were there, when I joined the service, I was a little apprehensive because I thought culture would be big, and was soon shown the reality. In those discussions that I remember amongst colleagues, intense discussions on foreign policy, in the haze of Scotch whiskey and imported cigarettes, the discussions were about military capability, about power projection, about nuclear power, and so on. Never was there a hint of sissy subjects like culture. I may share a personal experience which has remained in my mind. The Prime Minister's office at one time asked the MEA to send a panel of joint secretaries who could be considered for deputation to the Prime Minister's office. This is a normal practice. And the Foreign Secretary of the day sent a list of names. The Principal Secretary to the Prime Minister, who knew me very well, told me that he asked the Foreign Secretary, jokingly, why my name wasn't there in the list. And the Foreign Secretary of the day said, no, Mansingh is good for culture. So I understood that culture does not have the height that you require to be a good Foreign Service officer, but I have worn that as a badge of honor since then. So having said that, let me also say, I think it's entirely natural that a foreign office should focus on the hard issues, because they are priority issues. A foreign office is not necessarily the best ministry for dealing with cultural diplomacy. And therefore, maybe it's time for us to acknowledge that cultural diplomacy too is too serious a subject to be left to diplomats. We have many distinguished DG ICCRs here. I'm looking forward to hearing their views on this. Now let me come to the third issue, which is does ICCR need to reinvent itself? The ICCR, in my understanding, was established in 1950 as an intellectual institution, as a kind of think tank for exchange of ideas and cultural ties with countries that matter to India. Maulana Azad's particular interest was West Asia, especially Egypt. Pandit Nehru persuaded him to expand it to the whole world. Now, there are two major areas of responsibility in the ICCR today: the exchange of cultural delegations and the scholarship scheme. Neither of these were there with ICCR when ICCR was established. I think the cultural delegations came perhaps in the time of Professor Nurul Hasan, when ICCR was transferred to MEA. The scholarships handled by the entire government of India came lock, stock and barrel to the ICCR when I was there, because this followed a meeting I had with the then Education Secretary, Mr. Anil Bordia. Now, ICCR is a splendid cultural organization. It is a competent cultural organization. It has proved its competence in organizing major events, especially the festivals of India abroad and the festivals of partner countries in India. But the point I want to raise is it time for ICCR to shed its image of a cultural bandobast organization and revert to its original idea of a medium for intellectual and cultural exchanges? And here are some of my stray thoughts. Let the exchange of cultural delegations be minimized or perhaps be outsourced to organizations either in the private sector or within the government to bodies like the Sangeet Natak Academy or even the Culture Ministry. Let the scope of the scholarship scheme be expanded, because I think that is one of the things we are very good at offering, and it would establish India's role as the leading power for professional training in the whole world. There have been a lot of innovative ideas that have come into ICCR recently, like the Distinguished Indology Award, the International Sanskrit Award, the Distinguished Alumni Award. I think more and more of these schemes should be brought in so that we establish closer links with our partner countries. Indian cultural centers are an important instrument of cultural diplomacy. I think there should be more such institutions. Unfortunately, the few that are functioning are languishing because of lack of funds or inadequate staff, and I hope that they will be revitalized. I expect that all major partner countries of India should have an Indian cultural center, and others should at least have a cultural wing in the embassies. And I think we should expand the number of chairs we have in universities abroad. These are important for promoting the idea of India, and the bias should be removed They should be dealing with contemporary issues and not just with classical issues. Many of these suggestions have been made in the book, and I'm sure that many others will comment on that. One final thought is that I think it's also time to think of reorganizing the way the ministry works. I think a logical classification would be divided into broad divisions, one dealing with the hard issues of political relations, security issues, and all that. The other should have a focus on the soft power issues, and that should include the ICCR, the Foreign Service Institute, the Development Partnership Agency, and many others who can be clubbed together, whose functions can be synergized to give us a better image abroad. I think I have spoken a little too much and maybe a little too frankly, but I look forward to the way Mr. Ambassador Sahai presents his book, and I look forward to a very lively discussion thereafter. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Lalit. I won't call you Ambassador Mansingh because we are talking of connectivity and culture diplomacy. I must like to thank all the distinguished panelists, lot of persons who have worked in the area of culture diplomacy as Director General. I don't know how I got involved as a non-ICCR person to take this challenge of writing on this topic. I must thank the Director General of ICW, the three of them sitting here, you see, who put me on this job, Rajiv Bhatia, Nalit, and the President, and also Nivedita Ray, you see, whom I made work very hard, and she also, in reverse, made me work very hard to make sure that all the references, you see, are in tune, you see, with what I'm saying. I'm also very happy that Devre, another director, you know, I see here, okay, he was the one who was responsible when the book of my wife was released here in the ICCR. I think she had taken, as always, they said the women are not empowered, but in India, the women always take the lead, and she had taken the lead, and probably she gave me the challenge to write. Here I am. I think, Lalit, you have done a wonderful job, and so have you, because you have spoken, you see, some of the key words, you see, which I should be saying, and that makes it easier for me. At the same time, it makes it difficult, because you have hijacked the agenda. So I will not talk about what I have written or wanted to share with you. I'll probably talk about what you have said and what the challenges you have presented to us. First of all, I say, I think I want to make two or three broad comments. That I think my whole emphasis on cultural diplomacy is connectivity. When I started with connectivity, it was with a song, but I think it was much more than that. It was also the connectivity at the diplomatic missions, two diplomatic missions in Moscow and Washington, which are my first postings. And there I learned the importance of connectivity, where you had an ambassador, Tien Kol, and another first secretary who also became foreign secretary later, I.P. Venkateshwaran, you see, who taught you how to connect with the people, who taught you that we are all equal, whether we are third secretary, second secretary, first secretary, or something like that, you see. And I see some of the comrades sitting here, I think from that group. And also we could connect among ourselves. Again, in Washington, I learned about this connectivity, the importance of connectivity, from a master, Rasgotra, who couldn't be here with Aito because he's not feeling well. Because he told me how, or he told us in practice, you see, how as a junior officer, we could contribute towards this connectivity as he connected with the congressman. He could invite us as second secretary to his house, you see, as equals, you see, we learned about that. And I think that is absolutely essential and that should be. I think probably I was lucky to be posted in a bigger mission, you see. I think that one would learn and things like that, you see. But I think cultural diplomacy, again, is changing. What is cultural diplomacy? I think I used to have a lot of discussions with Lalit. It is a kind of a mini, I would say mini Plato Aristotle discussion, you see, when we used to discuss, agree, disagree, and come to some conclusions, or still maintain, you see, whatever we had. And I must say that I also made a full disclosure that in the book, that Lalit is my batchmate, my mentor and friend. And sometimes your batchmates were not friends. So, I think we luckily happened to be both all the three things together, and that is the truth. I mean, I'm not making anything, and it's not a, what you call, mutual admission. I didn't want Leonard to be here at some stage, because I didn't want to give the impression that it's a mutual admission society where we're talking about each other. But I think sometimes you do that, and you got stuck in that situation. Cultural diplomacy to me is connectivity. To me, I think cultural diplomacy is the starting point of understanding people. Where are we world? In this world, I think we see a lot of difficulties, a lot of disconnectivity, and I think you're more disconnectivity than connected these as words. How do we connect? The culture helps us. And culture, I think, helps us in two ways. First is what you call the vanguard action. It is through the cultural presence, you see, wherever you are. And the second happens later, I think, which I didn't agree with me when we're talking about that, the diplomatic, that you start having diplomatic dealings later on. You know, I call this, you see, this process is a five C's process. C is culture, connectivity, communications, learning, and then finally dealing, having business and cooperation. So this is how we are able to do that. To me, cultural diplomacy, I call it, is the foundation stone. And also here I agree with, I think, the famous American author, come diplomatician, who said cultural diplomacy is the first resort of kings. And I agree with him that it is the first, it is the starting point, you see, where you have to go. If there is a mistrust, I think it is, we have to build trust. These days, I think we are talking of surgical strikes, something like that. I think to me, what is more important at this juncture is to use cultural diplomacy as a vehicle for surgical strikes, but surgical strikes, you see, of sending arrows of love and friendship, prem ke baan, you see, so that we can win the hearts. We can win the hearts of people, that ultimately we have to win the hearts. Hearts and mind. Even after war, we have to connect. Whatever you say, you have to connect, you see. Where are we? India. India, again, we, well, like Lali said, we have 5,000 civilizations. Yes, I think you're absolutely right. I think you know more about culture than I know. And that's probably you could give a better discourse than I would be able to give, but I think I'm speaking from my personal experiences. We have to see that in India, this is answering some of your question, we do not have a policy as such, cultural policy. Nor do we have a foreign policy as such. Written format, of course we do have. You know, every time you read, see articles, and it's very easier to criticize them when people say that there's foreign policy, a thing like that, you see. But we do not have, you always fumbling, a thing like that. But do we need a written document? I raise a question. I think in India, it is the Indian's DNA is a culture diplomacy. Culture is in our DNA, then we don't need a written document. Again, when you're talking of culture diplomacy or diplomacy, it is changing. It is not something very static, it is dynamic. So if you do not have written document that gives you the flexibility to move forward, to change it, to adapt with the changing times. And that is much better, I would say, that we have that. What is the essence, as we are concerned, what is the strength of Indian culture, what is based on? And I would say the two things. One is we recognize diversity. And the second is that we celebrate pluralism. No, I like to hear maybe read two statements, quotations. Yes. from two of our leaders from different periods. One, I think I'd like you to make a guess. I think it's a question answer for you people to see who stands first. One is diversity is an Indian passion. We have it, tolerate it, and relish it. Other quotation is one aspect of these efforts is to respect, protect, and celebrate the diversity in our country. Could you make a guess? If not, could you say that it is made by the same person or persons from different political hues, political currency? Anybody want to take a challenge? No prizes. Maybe you get a free book if you not already bought it. Well, I think these two statements were made by one by Hamid Ansari, former vice president, in 2010. The second is made by the present vice president, McKenado, in 2017. So the point I'm making is that this shows the essence and the strength of our cultural diplomacy. This is what I say the idea of India. The idea of India is that we have to promote to see that we have a composite culture, we talk of that thing, and if you are able to do that, then only you can succeed and go forward. Where are we now? As you raised many questions, the role of the MEA or the importance of cultural diplomacy. I think reminds me, I'll also take two sentences. I think when I gave my book to our former external affairs minister, Natwar Singh, his nice man sent me a letter, you see. And what he said is very, very important from in your context. He said, when I joined service, this is Natwar Singh who's saying, in 1953, I did not know there's a word existed, cultural diplomacy. How true you are, you see. And he's so happy that I could write that. The second is again, where we had the visit by one of you again, distinguished predecessor or successor, Alan Nazareth. He came to Chandigarh. We promoted his book, recent book on Gandhi and things like that. And he told me when he was posted as Director General ICCR, he went to the Foreign Secretary, Rasgotra. He said, why you posted me? Because it was considered to be a sideline or you're a sidekick because you're not in the ministry. I mean, I can understand that because I was also a sidekick. When I was posted, you see, when I was posted from Malawi as a High Commissioner, I was coming back to India, I was asked to rush. And I rushed. I was supposed to join a joint secretary East Europe. And by the time I came, there was a revolution in the ministry, internal revolution. And I was shunted at joint secretary CPV, consular passport visa. Not many people prepared to take that challenge. But it was a very, very difficult job. I enjoyed, you know, I didn't care, see, because, you know, I'm a low key person, you know, I don't want to fly high and that kind of thing, you see. So I think, but it made me work, and I think we were able to do a lot of things like my small passport, you see, first passport officer conference, and things like that. A lot of things we did, I think money was in me. We worked on some of the issues, you know, like we had to introduce visas suddenly all over the world. And we were able to successfully achieve the results without any disruption. So that was a challenge, that was the thing, but that's how things happened. I think probably we are made to learn jobs, and whether it is good or bad, whether we are journalists, whether we should be able to achieve or not, you see, that is not the case, that's all the thing is there. Then I think the question you raised is MBA. Is MBA the right person? I think I did say that in my book, Lalit. I think you missed, and something I miss also when I read my book again, because I don't know where I put so many things are there. And I said that in 1950, what was the ICS set up, but it moved to MEA in 1970. I'll have to find that. If I find that, you have to give me some reward for that, you see. But I think it is there. It was not said straight away, but slowly, steadily, as I said, we are evolving, we are developing, a thing like that. See, we reached that state, and I'm very happy that we are there. Again, I think we have made, you see, lot of references to other points, other issues, ICCR. I would like to say that there's a full chapter on ICCR. And also there's a full chapter in the book, you see, on Ministry of Culture. There are full chapters, you see, on the vehicles. Education, which you raise also, education is one of the main things. And I have also said in my one recommendation that, you see, ICCF have to become a cultural plus organization. It has to move beyond the culture, and it has to ensure, you see, that, how many, 5 minutes more? It has to move beyond, you see, dances and music. And I think one of the areas which we have to put strength in emphasis is Distinguished Visitors Program. I think we hardly see anybody coming under the Distinguished Visitors Program. There are many other, I think, because of the paucity of time, I will not dwell into that. I think I divided my recommendations under five sectors. One is the broad issues at the macro level. The second is at the level of learning from other countries' experiences. And here I think we say that we learn a lot from other countries, like in Australia, in the area of education diplomacy. Then we have to learn about practices of the other cultural bodies. We have to do how we can restructure the ICCR and all those things. And I think finally, I think the point which we have made is to raise the point of Vishwa Guru. It is not my idea of India. I think it is the idea, I think I'm glad that we have the BJP leaders. It is the idea of the leadership in the BJP that it aspires that India should be a Vishwa Guru. In fact, I think this reference to Vishwa Guru was again by the present vice president, you see, in the recent conference they have soft power. I have said, yes, if you want to be Vishwa Guru, yes, by all means, but do this with all humility. Do it not as a hegemonic power. Do not see it from a cultural nationalism. And here I have quoted, I have quoted here, Guru Gobind Singh, where he said that you have to be Guru and Chela. Aape Guru, Aape Chela. So if you want to play the role of a Guru, you have to behave like a student also. If you do not behave like a student, you cannot teach. And the cultural diplomacy, as Lalit said, I 100% agree with him, that it is a two-way street, two-way channel. Many countries don't do that. But I think India has accepted, and working on that basis is a two-way channel. And I have also said, I think finally, the final note, is that we should start a process. Again, I call that Swami Vivekananda's civilizational dialogue, with the idea that we should have conferences every year, once in India, once in abroad, so that we treat them equal. And it is again about the equality, about everything else, you see. And unless, see, we are able to do that, it is not possible. Finally, I must say that I think the book is a bit fat. Yeah, and I think since we have stopped making jokes about the Punjabis or the Sikhs, and I think we have come to, I would say the book is like a fat Punjabi wedding, see. So that you see, you try to find, you see, everything you want, but at the same time you go unhappy. So I hope can I get my this? No, Uska. Give me any folder, make me so we don't see. So I hope that you find the book of interest to you. Here's my commercial. That's why I didn't say anything about the book, so that you can buy the book and read about it, you see. And I didn't make any details, comment, or a discussion. And I hope you read that. But I must say, I want to share one thing. You see, as I start that, culture is basically identity, you see. How do we identify one another, and how do we make
the differences you see between us, I would say disappear, to accept, like Swami Vivekananda used to say, that what is more important is acceptance, not tolerance. I think these days we had debate in India going on tolerance, intolerance, and that. I think he was a visionary who saw beyond that. And I said that I had recently an identity crisis myself. You know, I was happy that to see an article, a review in the Statesman by none other Mr. Chris Srinivasan. I'm showing you, I think you can see all of it, which give good identity to the book, say a monument work. But I lost my identity. The photo you see is not that of mine. Maybe it is pre-Marx. I think they say all six look alike, you know. So I don't know where they got it. But at the same time, I'm very happy to be here with you. At least thank God that ICWA has given me an identity. Both as an author, you see, of the book, and the book itself, you see. So I don't need words to express my thanks. I can go back happy, and I hope it is time to celebrate the book. What I say, badhaiya, you can give me badhaiya, and at the same time, you can give me a departure, say badhai. So you can say goodbye to me, bye-bye, thank you very much, good or bad, you see. See, whatever may be there, see, so you know, the choice is yours. The choice is yours. I'm there, I'm very happy, and I want to thank all of you, see, who have turned in large numbers. And I think this, what I'm saying, I think thanks to Lalit, I think I've changed the whole thing, what I want to say. I think it's different from what I planned and what I've been scribbling and writing, you know. And I think my wife was, and finally, I think I have to thank my wife. She must be very happy that I cluttered my room, you see. And I still clutter, you see. And she's happy, you see, that the book is out. I'm happy that I could create something about clutter. I think this, again, a part of Swachh Bharat, that you can create something from nothing or something like that. We have in Chandigarh the tradition of a rock garden, you see, which is created something. So if you have the will, if you have the can-do spirit, you can do that. And let's live in this can-do spirit, and let's celebrate democracy, your values, and you want a Vishwa Guru or a No Guru or whatever may be there. You have to respect your values, you see, and create that thing. Don't go by the words of Joseph Nye and all those. He doesn't know, but I think I talk, if you want to read about what I discussed, about what is soft power, what is public diplomacy in the book, you see, so please something for you to read. And thank you once again very much for all those things.
Thank you. Thank you, Pami, for that very passionate introduction to your book. Spoken like a true Sardar, with passion and a sense of humor. Thank you. We are running a little late, so I'll request our fellow panelists to be a little brief in their remarks. I think Ambassador Goel, it's your turn.
I think I still have 10 minutes.
A little less.
Okay.
I know that Foreign Service officers are trained for brevity.
I learned from you, sir.
Now, don't be the, like Pami, don't blame me for everything.
Good afternoon. First of all, I think a lot has been said about the book, so I really don't know what to say about the book. Ambassador Mansingh, he spoke so extensively about the book. All I can say really is that when I joined ICCR in 2010 as DG ICCR, I tried to find a theoretical construct or some kind of a background paper or a book which could tell me what I should expect to do in ICCR in terms of a cultural dialogue, cultural institution, cultural diplomacy, and there was nothing. I mean, there were lots of paper, parliamentary council committee, briefings, this and that, but there was no single book, there was no single note to really tell me what cultural diplomacy is all about, what actually we expect to achieve through this great institution called ICCR, with the exception of huge number of activities with a huge amount of budget, around 200 crores, which I spent very easily because there were lots of activities and I knew where the money should go. So I did that. But I think from that point of view, Ambassador Sahai's book is a great achievement. It's a great addition to really what we should have. It has filled a gap, a huge gap, which we had before. And I think it was a much needed book, really, that we have now. First of all, the book has clarified a conceptual framework for what cultural diplomacy should be. You called it connectivity. I have a different idea, which I will come to in a minute. But you defined what the cultural framework for the cultural diplomacy should be. And going beyond the conceptual framework to give a description of the various institutions, the instruments, what we have available in terms of achieving or implementing that conceptual framework, I think in a comprehensive, this book. It's a fat book, but this fat book, I think, is well deserved, really speaking. Coming to basically the various issues, I did go through some parts of the book, sir, not as extensively as one could, but I did. First of all, coming to the framework of cultural diplomacy, Ambassador Sahai calls it connectivity. I think we need, and he has made a very nice distinction between soft power and cultural diplomacy. I have always maintained during my days in ICCR and afterwards that we need to understand that cultural diplomacy is not about projection of soft power. A power remains power, basically. It's a show off. You show how powerful you are, how strong you are, and if it is culture, you show that you are a Vishwaguru. But that can become unpleasant at times, to show off and to demonstrate that you were a cultural superpower. I don't think one should ever do that. And that I think is soft power, really. Projection of power in one form or the other. For me, basically, cultural diplomacy is a distinction between the conflict of civilizations to the dialogue among civilizations. Cultural diplomacy is more about really obliterating barriers, overcoming barriers, using the cultural identities to demonstrate that despite the different cultural forms, despite differences in some of the cultural values that we might have, it is possible not just to coexist, but to intermingle, to be together and create something beautiful, something new, which will actually bring the two societies, the different societies together, and produce something which is so permanent, which is so durable, that it reduces automatically any possibilities of conflict or disagreements. To me, that is a cultural diplomacy, really. It is not a very easy process. Ambassador Mansingh said the culture is the most difficult thing to understand. I think cultural diplomacy is even more difficult to practice because that requires a lot of patience. It doesn't give immediate results. It needs you to understand the other side first before you can enter into any project. Just to give a few demonstrations, one has been mentioned by Ambassador Sahai in the book about the various activities we had undertaken for the ASEAN summit in India in 2013. And I still recall, Sanjay is here, so he was secretary at that time, and together we created something beautiful, really, to demonstrate how India and ASEAN can come together, not just on the basis of geographical proximity, but culturally, to demonstrate that there is no distinction, really. I still remember that beautiful production that we had in Rashtrapati Bhavan. I don't know if you remember that at all or not. It was a 1 hour long performance where different groups from the different ASEAN countries came together with the groups from India, and almost everyone, in fact not almost, everyone who came to us afterwards said that we can't believe it. We really don't know where the Indian culture began or the cultural forms from the other countries ended. It all came together in one single unified product, demonstrating how close we can be. Another demonstration came to me through another production that we had sponsored, we had actually promoted, Questionings. There you had the Norwegian black metal music conversing with Bharatanatyam. The Rodra of Norwegian black metal music, black music, came to respond to the Rodra of Bharatanatyam, and that was beautiful. Again, demonstrated that we do not need differences to so become so powerful to overcome us so much that we cannot come together in one common form. So that is what actually to me the cultural diplomacy is, where the forms can come together. Forms don't go away. That would be actually obliteration, that would be basically withering away of what our own identity is. But not to become so totally submerged in the identity that we cannot establish a dialogue with other identities. I think that is what Ambassador Sahai's book has said in different manner, but this is the idea that when you talk about connectivity or coming together really means. Second thing I would say is that we should not believe in the idea of supremacies. For me, the most beautiful message that I have ever really seen is Aham Brahmo Asmi Tattvamasi. Basically saying, if I am Brahma, so are you. We are all same. Let us enter into this kind of dialogue. Let us not really believe in compartments. Let us not, it's a very dirty word to use these days, let us not believe in polarization of people. We are all same. We can talk to each other. And that is what I think really cultural diplomacy is all about, to form cohesive societies together really. To do that really, apart from the institutions, which there are a lot of mentioned here in the book, I think two or three things which are most important is they have been mentioned here, the chairs and the conferences. The chairs, I think, are very, very important because the chairs can become a hub in the different universities where people from the other communities gravitate to enter into that conversation with what that Indianism is. Yes, sir. That Indian is it 2 minutes, Bill. Indianism is. Therefore, chair not just as a kind of an academic thing, but to become a hub, a collaboration where the different people can come together to understand where we come from and understand what the Indianism is, really is, or become a hub for the Indian research on the Indian religious subject. Similarly, conferences. Now, the conferences that ICCR does are very different, really. It doesn't talk about just what we want to talk about. We choose a subject, or ICCR chooses a subject, at least during my time, we chose subjects which were actually closer to the countries where we would do the conferences. And those conferences will involve that country's academics, academics from the neighboring countries there, the region, and Indian academics. Again, something beautiful came up. It was a dialogue. So therefore, I think two or three things were important in terms of establishing dialogue, and they have been all mentioned here. Two things which I thought there could be greater focus on. One is we should remember that cultural values can be permanent, or at least more durable. Even they change over time. But cultural forms need to evolve, need to change depending on the environment, depending upon the change in technology. So many changes take place. Cultural forms can evolve and change. Youth is an important part of this change. I think we should focus on the role which the youth can play in establishing the dialogue, number one. Technology. The Indian youth is known as Jugadu, or is known as kind of a techie, but he's a problem solver. No one idiom has done more for Indian cultural connect than the youth and the Bollywood. I think we should focus on that. Yoga can become part of it, extension, but we need to focus on this thing. Finally, all I need to say is that really speaking, that we need to build on working together, youth, Bollywood, yoga, etc., etc. But most importantly, it has to be at a civilizational level. Develop those civilizational dialogue which can actually bring the countries together, which can bring the societies together. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh. May I call upon Mr. Tarun Vijay to make his remarks briefly.
Dear Ambassador Raghvan, Ambassador Sahai and friends, my apologies first of all to arrive a little late, but I'm really honored to share my views, and I must say that what Ambassador Lalit Mansingh said has really provoked me to say something and also inspired me. He's a good friend for the last 25, 30 years or maybe more. I think I must first congratulate Ambassador Sahai for bringing out this wonderful book. It's a book which to me is sort of a reference book about what Indian foreign policy had been doing, foreign office has been doing, and it also gives ideas at what it should not have been doing. And you said that it's a very fat book. So Ambassador Sahai knows that in Punjabi, the beauty is described through a word, and that word is mutiar. If it's not mutiar, then it's not beautiful. So I must say that we, the coming generations and the students of Indian foreign policy would ever be grateful to you for this very significant contribution, and my thanks to ICWA and Ambassador Raghavan also. So Ambassador Raghavan, whenever I see him, something very, very great, inspiring comes before my eyes. I was one of those two very rare journalists who were permitted, allowed by Pakistan High Commission to visit Balochistan. And we crossed Munabao by road, and till we reached after Mirpur Khas and Las Bela and Mithi, and we reached Hingol, beautiful place. And we had a function there. All along the roads, on the two sides of the roads, and we were not very big people. We were just gyreens and two Sahafis in that, me and Avik Sarkar. And on both sides of the roads, there was a sea of people. And every one of them was a Muslim Rajput. They were waving at us. They were welcoming us. It was something unbelievable unless you had seen it from your own eyes. And when we reached Hingol, there was a fabulous lunch ready for us, very, very vegetarian, and it was specially made for us, and we saw Ambassador Raghavan looking at us from rooftop there. It's something that brought tears in our eyes. This was Pakistan, and we were passing through Amarkot, Las Bela, and that. This is what culture is. It connects. And Ambassador Sahai is 100% right when he says that in the book also, he has spoken about connectivity. There is nothing else in the world that connects as beautifully and as strongly and as permanently as culture. But I don't think that culture can be a part of diplomacy. The moment it becomes a part of diplomacy, it becomes a victim of a bureaucratic setup and some kind of a rudeness which we see. Why I say that? Why I say that? Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ambassador Akhilesh. Why I say that? Because I have seen it. The spread of culture and establishing connectivity through culture demands only giving without any expectation of any return. The moment it becomes a part of diplomacy, then you are working on a cultural department in hope of some return. I have been to Lishan, and many of the stalwarts are here, sir. And Lishan Buddha was inspired and created by an Indian monk. 1250 feet statue on a single stone in China. I think 2,000 kilometers north to Beijing. And when you go there, they have put a statue of the rishi, of the monk, who inspired Lishan Buddha about 1,100 years before. And the statue of that monk doesn't have eyes. He is the person who spread Buddhism in China. But he never expected anything in return. He gave his life. And there is a story behind that. My Chinese friends, they told me that in those times, the local authorities were very jealous of the monk who went from North India, maybe from Kashi or area, something like that, crossed all the desert, Himalayan desert, reached there, adopted their language, adopted their way of living. And the local authorities felt that he must be a very wealthy person. He is so close to the king that he made the king to order creating that big statue on that hillock. So he must make us happy. And they stopped the work in between. And they sent a message that, well, you know, there are a couple of things that have to be done. So demand was met by sending a message to the local authorities, maybe municipal authorities, that, well, on an appointed date you come and Swamiji or the monk or the Buddhist monk, he would give the most precious jewels he has to you. But kindly don't stop the work. So cut this story short, when the authorities were very happy, the officials came in expectation of some real pearls and jewels. But when they opened the tray, they found the two eyes of the monk. That this is all that I have. I have nothing more precious than these eyes, but please don't stop the work of creating the statue of Buddha. This is culture. And it cannot be a part of diplomacy. Because you have to give everything to spread. The same thing is about Angkor Wat, and I agree. We forgot about Angkor Wat. Angkor Wat was not rediscovered by Hindus or by Indians. It was rediscovered by the French. And how many of us really go there? The thousand Shivalinga River, I had been there thrice. And many other such places, battle between Thailand and Cambodia took place on Pra Vihir, the Shikareshwar Mahadeva temple, India did not know about it. We didn't care about it. 17 soldiers lost their lives on that hillock to capture that hillock. So when I went there, the Foreign Office formally advised me not to go there. Formally. But I pushed my way as a member of parliament. I went there, I saw the place, I wrote about it, and Salman Khurshid was very kind. He put up an exhibition of a BJP MP in ICCR. He inaugurated it. That was the time. So culture means a connectivity. When you lose connectivity, then you lose culture. And I must also make a very brief thing about Vishwa Guru. I agree with you, sir. I fully agree with you. I think when we say about Vishwa Guru, we don't show the arrogance of being a guru to the world. We are called Vishwa Guru, or like Shankara Bhagavatpad. He was known as Jagat Guru Shankaracharya. Why Jagat Guru Shankaracharya? Because he spread the universal values. The universal values were reflected in their thoughts. So that was the meaning to me. And I think presently the best thing that we can say that we should be the best Vishwa Shishyas in the world, not the gurus. I know my very good friend Amjad Ali Khan. He's a Sarod master, Acharya. But he told me that, Tarunji, whenever I create a new raga, I'm very afraid because I feel that maybe I may make mistake. So you are good and great till you are having an attitude, a mindset of a Shishya, a student. The moment you think that you have become Acharya, your fall begins. So Vishwa Shishya is the best thing that we can do, but Shishya should also be a brilliant Shishya. You cannot have a duffer Shishya and then they say, I am a Vishwa Shishya. So I was as a member of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on External Affairs. We went to Nalanda and we had a meeting with the Vice Chancellor and all those connected with the, it was about 3-4 years, yeah. So culture means understanding. When I asked in that meeting that Vice Chancellor, Madam Sir, Madam, please, you are here to represent the cultural glory of the India that was Buddhist. So who was Pratham Acharya and the creator of Nalanda University? And she said that, I don't know. I said that he was Nagarjuna, who established Nalanda University. So even if we are Shishyas, we should be intelligent Shishyas and not those Shishyas who even do not know what our culture means about. In the end, sir, we were told, I must give an anecdote of Swami Vivekananda. He spread Hindu Dharma all over. But he also brought Jesus Christ from the West to India. He never showed that kind of arrogance that I am your guru. He was the biggest, the cyclonic Hindu monk of the country who revived interest in Hindu Dharma. And he was never apologetic about it. But he made Ramakrishna Mission the only Hindu organization which till this date celebrates Jesus and Christmas officially world over. That's the attitude. That's the mindset that Indian culture presents. And we were good in education. I must end with one small line. I interviewed the third RSS Sarasangha Chalak and his name was Professor Rajendra Singh. He was the head of the physics department in Allahabad University and he worked with Professor C.V. Raman. And I asked, sir, Raju Bhaiya, what kind of a India you have in your mind, your dreams? Very strong, superpower and all that, that perhaps people think that we have. His reply was, no. I never want India that is known in the world as a super military power. I want an India which is known in the world as a Gyana Bhumi and a place where people come to learn a good character. Gyan aur Charitra ki Bhumi Bharat bane. Isse badhkar mera Bharat ke bare mein koi sapna nahi. I think this is culture. If you are working on a culture, then you are not working to become a military superpower, but you are showing some kind of a humility and some kind of a passion to give the best that you have without expecting anything in return. This is what I learned from Ambassador Sahai's book. Thank you, sir, for giving us this fat but very, very good book. With these words, I conclude my statement. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Tarun Vijay. Now we have our last panelist, Ambassador Akhilesh Mishra, Director General of the ICCR. Akhilesh.
Thank you. लोग मुझको भी कहते हैं दुआ के लिए किस कदर रब ने मेरे ऐब छिपा रखे हैं. I'm truly humbled to be part of this great panel and also to speak before such an audience which has many distinguished colleagues whom I consider my guru. I'm truly honored, sir, for Dr. General Dr. Raghavan for your invitation and also for presenting me this beautiful book. On the day I actually took over as Director General of ICCR just a month ago, and I must applaud the initiative taken by ICWA for bringing out this publication, which is the most comprehensive work on soft power and diplomacy and laying out the nuances of all the aspects involved. And as incoming Director General, I found it extremely useful and it very, very educational for me. In terms of the content, almost every page I read, I remembered Mirza Ghalib. Dekhna takreer ki lajjat ki jo usne kaha, maine ye jana ki goya ye bhi mere dil mein hai. Mr. Sahay, I agree with almost everything that you have said. And also my very dear friend, Mr. Vijay ji, I entirely agree with what you have said too. Ambassador Sahai has very rightly cautioned us about loosely using culture in the framework of power play and as a diplomacy, a diplomatic instrument or instrument of power, even if it is used as a soft power. I sincerely feel, again, because fortunately for me, the government of India has not initiated a proper official policy on cultural diplomacy or soft power. Therefore, even as the acting as a serving Director General, I can claim that it's all my personal view. I sincerely believe that we have to be cautious in very casually and loosely using imported words and co-opting and unwittingly endorsing them, because ours is a really, really complex, multi-layered and very challenging cultural ethos and societal ethos to put in very simplistic terms in which the Western world is used to narrating situations. There are many things which we have grown up contemplating on. They are very difficult to translate into Western thoughts, whether it's a Brahma, whether it's Atman, whether it's a Karma, whether it's a Yoga, even Guru. As Ambassador Sahay mentioned in his book, how do you explain to a Western audience about a Guru who is also a Chela? And that concept is, I was reading Vedas, and it actually flows from Vedas. Even though Vedas are the divine message, but they have inherent questions and answers. The one who is asking questions is also giving replies. The process of learning and teaching, both are two sides of the same coin. It's a simultaneous process. These are, as Indians, as inheritors of great philosophy and great culture, I think we have to be cautious in putting benchmarks and instrumentalities which are quite simplistic in nature to describe situations in India which are very complex, very, very inherently sophisticated and complex. Particularly the use of word power. In Sanskrit, there is a very beautiful couplet which says, Vidya vivadaya dhanam madaya shaktihi paresham parpidanaya khalasya. Jo sadhor viparit metat jnanaya danaya cha rakshanaya. Jo vidya of in hands of an evil person is for vivad, is for debate, acrimonious debate. Money, prosperity is for arrogance of an evil person. And power is for oppressing others, for torturing others, intimidating others. On the other hand, for a nobleman, knowledge is for learning.
illumination, self-illumination. Money and prosperity is for gifting, helping others. And power is for rakshanaya, for protection. And therefore, I sincerely feel that we have to be cautious in using words like cultural diplomacy. Government of India, fortunately, still has not given any definition, and ICCR is still about Indian Council for Cultural Relations. My preferred framework is developing, strengthening relations rather than indulging in diplomacy, even if it's a soft power diplomacy. Because diplomacy is inherently negative in its conception, because it inherently involves that short of using instruments of war, you are persuading, trying to influence and prevail over someone else. Whereas cultural work, cultural developing, cultural relations involves mutual respect. That comes the first. Mutual respect of each other's identity. Each other's identity is absolutely unique. No two human beings in the world are identical. They cannot be identical. And we have to respect the individuality, the identity of everyone else, and relate to the other with the same dignity, same respect. And that is the message of Aham Brahmasmi, or when we say Namaste. And also, I caution about use of word, too much of use of word kutumbam. Mr. Lalit Mansingh gave the full sloka. So I think ayam nijah paro veti ganana, that is the key to focus. Not on kutumbam. Today we are aware what happens in kutumba. Again, friends, I feel that the kutumba is not the idea to promote. Idea to promote is get over that feeling of me and you. And this is what Indian philosophy actually teaches us. In Atharvaveda, there's a really very beautiful shloka, mantra, which says, Pari vishwa bhuvanani ayam ritasya tantum vitatam drishekam. He says that I have traversed all the universes, all the worlds, not just this universe that we are in, but all the universes. And I have seen that there is a web of consciousness, a web of Rita, Tantu of Rita, which is pervading all of us. And in that conception, every entity, not only human beings, not only animals and plants, but all animate and inanimate objects, we are all connected in a web. All of us are like a small node in the larger scheme of things. And that is why that interdependence and interconnectedness, again to refer to Mr. Sahai's key thrust, that is about connecting and understanding. Culture is not just about dance and music. Culture is about ideas, sharing ideas, learning from each other. And that is what we need to focus more. And about ICCR, it has become a very useful whipping boy for everyone. And again, ICCR was founded in 1950. Mandate is cultural relations. In 1953, Sangeet Natak Academy was established. What does it mean? Sangeet and Nataka not part of a culture. 1954, Lalit Kala Academy was established. Then again, Sahitya Academy was established. Can you think that literature is not part of culture? The government of India, in its own wisdom, for some reason, has created the many silos. We have to come across. We have to work for a larger cause of India, for the profile that it deserves. And lastly, we have to be honest. Any institution which is funded by the government of India, indirectly by the people of India, deserves value for the money it is spending. And as just 1 month old Director General, I'm very conscious that it is not happening. We are not short of money. We are short of good ways of spending money. And that is why, friends, I'm really grateful to have this opportunity, and I look forward to calling on many of you in the audience to get your ideas, suggestions, and guidance. Once again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Akhilesh. Thank you for contributing your panitya to the discourse. Friends, it's now time for the most important part of the program, which is question and answer. We do have a limited time, but I think we should have a lively discussion. Do raise your hand, and please identify yourself, ask a short question, and identify the panelists who should answer your question. Right, first I think I'll come to you. Professor Buni, I'll come to you after that.
Okay, no problem.
Professor Buni, I saw his hand first.
Thank you very much. Very exciting panel on this great book. Two very short observation come questions. One comes out of the subtitle of the book, that is Pluralism in a Globalized World. And there was a lot of emphasis on Buddhism. And I know that in our diplomacy these days, there are also references to Hinduism. But if you are really celebrating pluralism, first, can you do it by polarizing your own society, number one. Number two, if you have to project culture, which is composite in India, full of diversity, why we should not take Islam also on the board besides Hinduism and Buddhism? The second question is, there are a lot of reference to the India chairs which have been put up, and ICCR has been working on this for a long time. Now, how do you carry the idea of India chair and idea of India through the India chair if you appoint, say for instance, a Bangladesh expert in Tanzania, a Southeast Asia expert in Russia? We have made a total mess of an excellent facility which has been created, but this is how we do out of patronage. Thank you.
Thank you. Ambassador Karakhan.
For me, before I came to this, I came here with a lot of skepticism that, you know, what kind of discussion are we going to have? You were kind enough to have a book sent to me, which I did not deserve, but since we are friends, I suppose you thought I should get a copy. And I must confess, I have not read the whole of it, but I have read some sections and some chapters. But I'm glad, I'm very glad that I came, because the kind of discussion, the debate, then the presentations, they're really fabulous, fantastic. And I think it went beyond my most vivid expectations that there would be such a high caliber presentation and discussions. I'm glad that BJP has an MP like you, Tarunji. Because if a BJP MP can say...
I hope you write a line to my president.
I don't know whether your president would appreciate one line from me. But the thing is that when you say that India should forget about power, great power, superpower, military power, I very much endorse that. But unfortunately, the leadership does talk about India being a great power, military power, not cultural power, I think. And the thing I like most about you, and all, I think all of you, Misraji has made some fantastic presentation. I don't want to go individually, but when you said that cultural diplomacy should not be a part of MEA's jurisdiction, I think there's something to think about it, I think. And the reason also you mentioned, that when it goes to external affairs, everything that we do in external affairs, we expect reciprocity. We expect some return. If the Prime Minister is received somewhere by the Prime Minister there or President there, that country will expect that we will expect extend the same kind of courtesy. So, nishkam karma jise kehte hain, that is, I think, that should be the bedrock of Indian diplomacy, cultural diplomacy, or whatever. And I think that since having listened to the present DG ICCR, one feels that the ICCR is in good hands, and there is going to be some original thinking about the role of ICCR. And perhaps the, I think in 1970, I don't know who the foreign minister was, but that foreign minister must have had a lot of clout to get this ICCR into the Minister of External Affairs. I don't want to know who the minister was, but I think obviously that's how things happen in our country. But I think that Mr. Mishra can do a lot of original thinking about the role of ICCR. I don't have any questions, but I did want to express my deep gratitude to Pami for writing a book that has provoked such incredible discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Ghosal.
Just a small comment. You mentioned about humility, and Ambassador Sahay also mentioned about identity. Now, I just wanted to give an idea, is that while I was teaching in Japan on a course on India's foreign policy, after I gave a whole list of writings by Indians, interestingly, at the end of my semester, a Japanese student, you know, very disturbingly told me that you Indians are so bright that you cancel out each other. Now, if this is the image and the identity that India projects, I think that is, of course, minus cultural thing. The second thing is both Ambassador Mansingh and others have mentioned about lack of culture as a part of focus in India's foreign policy at the beginning. I had the opportunity to go through the declassified documents in 1966. Kannampilli, who was ambassador to Indonesia, you know, he wrote about 18 notes, communications, to the ministry. Chandrasekhar Dasgupta was the undersecretary at that time, and I also read his notings. If you just collect those, you know, the communication, the statements, and the thing that came out in 2012, at the time of 20th anniversary of India-ASEAN thing about cultural interactions, they can be compared, similar language. And there were 18 notes by Kannampilli about the culture, and the emphasis on that was that our strength lies in culture, which is not the second thing also. There is a difference between what is proclaimed and what is actually practiced. We talk about promoting academic interactions between Indians and our other counterparts in Southeast Asia and all that. I can give you an example. When somebody applied for a project on a joint collaborative effort between an Indian scholar, a Malaysian scholar, and an Indonesian scholar on India-Southeast Asia engagements, the project sat in MEA for 4 years, and after 4 years, there was a terse reply that we don't have funds.
Thank you. I think we should ask the panelists to respond very briefly. May I start with Pami? You address them, and maybe the others can join.
Hello. Yes. Well, I must thank Ambassador Karaka and others, you see, for making our day. We are happy that you are here, and I hope we do that. My sending the book to us, connectivity. That's the whole essence. And we continue understanding each other. You see, that's what is the spirit in which we have done and we doubt. I think a few other points were made. I think I'll probably touch on some points made by the panelists, you see. I think the word kutum, I think when I talk of the kutum bakam, and kutum for me is to respect or nurture the diversity of the kutum,
not from one person to another kutum. So I think basic thing is when you talk of that, we are accepting, we are promoting pluralism, we are promoting diversity, and that is the one, and as I also said in my book, that the five fingers are not the same. How we can live together? As five fingers can live, being different, so similarly, see, the kutum can live together, and they have to learn live together. I think Professor Muni made a very valid point, and he said that pluralism. Yes, in fact, my whole book is about pluralism. You know, if you go through that, it is not talking about pluralism ethos values in India, but I think the difficulty at the present juncture is that the question is coming whether we are still really pluralistic or not, whether there is a gap between theory and practice. You see, are we really pluralistic? Are we really still composite culture? We want protest. We have, I think the ICR, I must give credit, ICR had also done some programs, you see, on Islam also. They had a conference of Dara Shikoh, you see. I mean, these are very solitary examples. But I would not say that, you see, we have, I think Prime Minister Modi has gone abroad in Tehran, and he's spoken of, again, the composite culture, where you learn Sufism from India, and India sending Sufism, and all those things are there. But I think we have to do something, or ICCR will have to do something, to change the perceptions. The perceptions are that India is going in a different way. I said in my book that if we want to be either Vishnu Guru or Vishnu Chela or whatever that is, that we have to stick to the idea of India. Unless we stick to the idea of India, we cannot go. And what is very important is not what you say, what is not India's story, but how the India story is perceived or listened to in another country. That is important. So we have to ensure, and I think here the media has a great role to play. And I said that media can be a connective bridge. And then again, I think the foreign ministry, I think they have a role. And in fact, you see, I studied in the book, you'll find that most of the countries, you see, the cultural diplomacy is handled by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. What imagine, because ultimately, they have that. Yes, I agree with you, see, your points. There's a difference. I think when you talk of cultural diplomacy, I'm not talking empowerment. I think I don't want to see cultural diplomacy to be used as a soft power, even though it's soft power. I'm making a distinction. I think you look at that. I hope I answered some of the questions.
Thank you. Mr. Tarun Vijay, you want to say something?
I was rather surprised to get this question from Professor Muni, because India, if India is not plural, and India had not been representing the vibgyor of all the cultures that we have today, then no other country in the world is plural, and no other country can be described as representing the various shades of their land. It's only India. I had been to most of the countries in the world. I have seen not Guruvayur temple in any embassy. I haven't seen Akshardham temple. I have seen only one image, and that image is Taj Mahal. Essentially, quintessentially in everywhere where I had been. And I mentioned this Taj Mahal because Taj Mahal is a place where still, till this date, the Muslims offer namaz. We celebrate the destruction of Hindu temples by celebrating Qutub Minar every single embassy in the world. Nobody has objected to it. Nobody has ever said that stop doing it because this is Islamic structure which was built over the debris of 27 Hindu temples. You can see the board is still there by Archaeological Survey of India put up in the Qutub Minar. So we are like that, sir. If we are not like that, if we were not like that, we would not be India, and we would not be the believers in our dharma. Having said that, every country has a principal ethos. And to be apologetic and to be shameful about the principal Hindu civilizational stream of the country is also as bad as hiding the other cultures. Thank you.
Anybody else?
No, very briefly, I think 2 points raised by Professor Muni. Firstly, about plurality of religion. I think what we should talk about is the plurality of cultural influences and not religion, because that will always lend into the kind of disruptive debate that we are now having really. We talk about Persian influences, Persian and Sassanian culture, they have been so similar, Sanskrit and Persian, they were together. And we have had a seminar in IIC on the interaction between these two cultural mainstreams. If you look at the architecture in India, there is a huge influence of Turkish, Persian influences, Arabic influences, it's Central Asian, Taj Mahal, etc. They're all part of this thing. But having said all that, I think the idea is to talk about how different influences have come together rather than talk about any single particular religion really, because that, as I said, could lead to difficulties. About the chairs, very briefly, I completely agree with you. This chairs program is a magnificent program that ICCR has, but mismanaged, simply because it provides patronage to several, and because of the patronage system, we are not able to get the right people in the right slot. Thank you.
I saw a hand in the back first. I'm going to recognize you. Yes, sir. Back there.
Me?
Mr. Chan. Please announce yourself.
Me?
Hi, and others in the panel. I wanted to ask you, what is loudly?
Speak a little louder, please.
Came across in the very fine observations in this panel discussion, it was this subtle distinction between cultural diplomacy, cultural relations, and soft power and all that. These are very fine idealistic distinctions if one look at it, but my I'm just a little puzzled that if you are not so sure about, say for example, you're questioning the rationale or raison d'etre using, say, cultural diplomacy at all, then why do we have institutions to promote it? If one is so squeamish about the whole idea of soft power, and you know the notion of soft power as embedded in Joseph Nye, getting others to want the outcomes that you want through attractiveness of your foreign policy, knowledge, culture, and all that, those cannot be entirely negated. Also linked to that is that when we talk about India's cultural diplomacy, how do we see it in the competitive context, say vis-a-vis say China, which spends millions, even billions, you know, through Confucius Institutes and other institutions. Where do we see our diplomacy going, you know? These are very fine, I mean, it was excellent to listen to all this, you know, but looking ahead, how do you see the future of cultural diplomacy, if you're still comfortable with that term?
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Ambassador Surendra Kumar.
First of all, congratulations to my neighbor, Ambassador Sahai, after very heavyweight comments about the fat book. Let me say a few things, if you allow me, sir, about practical point of view. Out of nearly 36 years of my service, I spent 28 years outside India. I've done a lot of cultural work, even at the places where nobody will do it. And when you do practical work, what really matters is innovative ideas, imaginative ideas, out of box, and a good boss who supports you. I will give an example. I had a discussion at Kellogg School of Management. What was that? Mahatma Gandhi in 21st century. We have September 11, 2001, tragedy in New York. I discussed Chicago University. Relevance of Gandhian thought after September 11, 2001. You can do it. Dance, all do it. I did many of the retrospect, but I also got Syam Benegal teaching films in Northwestern University. I got Amjad Ali Khan staying in Chicago University and teaching music. We can do a lot of things. I was in Kenya as High Commissioner. UNEP, we are also PR to UNEP Habitat. We go to those halls where UN Secretary General comes. We all go there, have discussions. I organize there Gandhi 21st century, India 21st century. In that hall, we had 40 feet by 30 feet stage where the African singer, Mrs. Olga, who did her MA in music from BHU, singing Bestav Jante. You have to have. You were Sir High Commissioner in London. At the same hall, I had presented Pandit Ravi Shankar, Pandit Bhimsen Joshi, Pandit Sukumar Sharma, Pandit Jasraj, Ustaz Jali Khan, Hariprasad Chaurasia, Sukumar Sharma, same High Commission. I would like to know how many before, after. It all happened because I had a boss called Maharaj Krishna Raskotra who encouraged me to do it. Unless we have support, you can't do it. Otherwise, you can go on doing. And I must say that many times we have done things without support of ICCR or the MEA. Sometimes some of the good things you do, they will not help you, they will obstruct you. I had first time in the world retrospect Raj Kapoor films in Chicago. I got 7 congressmen, four senators giving kind of messages. I asked ME to arrange my message from PM. I was sent message, Foreign Secretary has been consulted. It is felt there is no need of any message. I said, what to do? I went up. I had Prime Minister called Atal Bihari Vajpayee. He gave the message for that brochure, 3 long paragraph, which JS has informed me Foreign Secretary feels there's no need. So sometimes our MEA doesn't help. Practical side different. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Razia Doshi.
I am very glad I came here today. It has reinforced a bit of my identity, which I feel I have lost. Not just me, but many like me, including Hamid, Salma, and stalwarts that you know. It is very, very sad to be living in a world today when, not too long ago, at the time of the Kanishka crash in Ireland, the BBC interviewed me and said, what kind of a country is this where you have 14 different religions on one plane? And I said, that is what we call Indianness, the invisible threads that bind us close and completely together. It was not the 90% of the relatives or the people who died were Canadian citizens, yet they cried on Kiran's shoulder, not on the Canadian ambassador's shoulder. This thing called Indianness, this thing that we put as cultural affinity and togetherness should not be lost. Today, it's getting so polarized that I'm ashamed of my name, where earlier I used to be very proud of it.
Thank you, Raja. I think we'll take a few more questions and make it the final round as we're running out of time. Yes, sir. Please announce yourself and ask your question.
Thank you, sir. My name is Kartar Kapoor. I'm a student of Balanced Comparative Studies in the Evolution of Histories. Sir, I have a few observations to make. सबसे पहले कि हम 5000 साल की बात करते हैं, बार-बार ये repeat है, बड़े-बड़े leader भी यही कहते हैं, 5000 साल पर, कहाँ से ये data आई 5000 साल पर? Why can't it beyond that? Why can't it beyond that? What's the significance of 5000? मैं ये क्यों कह रहा हूँ? हम बार-बार ये कहते हैं हिंदू कब आया? इंडू कब आया? इंडस कब आया? इंडिका कब आया? उससे पहले क्या था? उससे पहले पुरातन था सनातन था आदिवासी, जिसकी हम आज कदर नहीं करते, जिसको हमने शेड्यूल कास्टों के साथ मिला दिया, ये हमारा कल्चर है। हम अपने आदि अपने कितने पूर्वजों को, जिससे हम यहाँ तक पहुंचे हैं, उनको हमने शेड्यूल ट्राइब्स के साथ मिला दिया। यही हमारा कल्चर क्या? यही 5000 साल में हमने सीखा है क्या? ये 5000 साल की बात मैं कर रहा हूँ। पहली बात तो ये है। दूसरा ये कहा जाता है कि विश्वगुरु की बात हुई, विश्वचेला की बात हुई। अगर सभी लोग विश्व का हम अगर भारतवासी विश्वगुरु बनना चाहते हैं तो दूसरे लोग क्यों नहीं विश्वगुरु बनना चाहेंगे? तो इसका मतलब कॉन्फ्लिक्ट खड़ा करना चाहते हैं आप? सभी विश्वगुरु बने तो चेला कौन बनेगा? व्हाट इज द पॉसिबिलिटी वी कैन ऑल बी चेलास and have a discourse and discuss and arrive at a consensus. But if we all become gurus, then we will end up nowhere. So this is not possible, sir. ये बिल्कुल ही निरर्थक विचारधारा है. और lastly मैं ये कहना चाहूँगा, मुझे माफ कीजिएगा, मैं comparative study का student हूँ, तो मैं तो किसी हद तक किसी चीज़ में जाता हूँ. हम इतना कुछ discuss है, सब controversial है. एक चीज़ बहुत बड़ी controversial है, culture. सब लोग बोले एक ही में, अगर एक ही सज्जन की की बात करूं, उन्होंने कल्चर के बारे में तीन स्टेटमेंट दी. कल्चर इज गिविंग, कल्चर इज कनेक्टिविटी, कल्चर इज अंडरस्टैंडिंग. एक ही बार में इतनी बारी परिभाषा कर दी है. हम तो कल्चर को डिफाइन ही नहीं कर पा रहे, सो हम डिस्कस करके आप क्या कर रहे हैं.
थैंक यू. एनीबडी एल्स? ओके, वी आर डन. पमी, यू गो फर्स्ट.
I think let me go to Manish Chand. I think you asked question between soft power, you see, cultural diplomacy, things like that. Yes, I think we are trying to understand. I said this whole book is an understanding, you see, and I approach this book, writing the book, you see, as a student or a chela, you see, I have understanding, you see, and I have still found, you see, lot of things are lacking. I'm still discovering new things like that, you see. But I made this distinction from a limited point of view as cultural diplomacy to be seen more of connectivity, more accepting others as they are, not forcing your views. On the other hand, you see, soft power is empowerment. What are you may say? I mean, you use whether you convert in them, their youth, this kind of thing, you see, it is empowerment. And if you see culture diplomacy as a connectivity bridge, then you promote understanding. This is what you're saying, your point also, see that. See, then we are trying to promote understanding. We are trying to, you see, what you call, open the doors, what Mahatma Gandhi said that. It is, let the wind blow from many directions, you see. But still, you remain steady as far as you're concerned, your own culture, you're still path, but ultimately, it depends on you also. You have your identity, accept others' identities, and continue that. Secondly, about China being competitive, I think each country has their own systems. We have our system, but I think I fully agree with you. We have much limited resources, in fact, that's what I covered in the book, in that ICCR is doing wonders with the limited resources they have. They you know, we can do wonders. I'm just thinking that they have $20 million budget. What is nothing? You see, one businessman running from where with 9,000 crores rupees. Well, where the ICR budget, you see? Nowhere near that, even that, you see. So even if we can give even one-tenth of the budget of a businessman, you see, who's flown out of India, I think ICCR could do wonders. Committed people. We have to empower the DG, and I hope the new DG would be empowered, but times are sometimes, you know, you don't want to be empowered because then you have the responsibility also. So it is both, you see where, how you can empower yourself and get things done and move with that. Yes, we do need innovative ideas. We are learning every day. That does not mean if that we didn't discuss about cultural diplomacy yesterday, we should not be discussing about cultural diplomacy today. We have discussed today's definition of cultural diplomacy, which I felt may not be correct. That's why I said, I conclude in my book that this is the beginning. You are all going to add to this framework which we have done, go change in different direction. I mean, I'll accept that. I mean, that is, to me, that is cultural diplomacy. I think I answered most of the questions I have to answer, which I'm not expert on culture. I think I leave it to Lalit to define what is culture, see. I can define only cultural diplomacy, and where I said culture, for me, in the context of cultural diplomacy, is a wider construct. It means everything. It means everything under the sun. That's why my book is Everything Under the Sun, and that follows the pattern of the Indian cultural agreements, where we could everything, when we enter into a cultural agreement, we put everything, you see, which basically helps in connectivity. But culture, yes.
Very briefly, to respond to what Manish was asking, a kind of a comparison between the cultural diplomacy efforts of India and the other countries. There is a huge difference between what the other countries do and what we do. Essentially, resource is one constraint. What China spends on their public diplomacy, I'm making a difference here, Confucian Center is part of public diplomacy, not cultural diplomacy. What they spend on the public diplomacy efforts, our budget is not even 10% of that really. So that makes a difference. But more than that philosophical approach, we believe in collaborative systems, while theirs is actually just handing it over. Confucian Center was one such thing. And wherever the Chinese then withdrew their support, centers closed down. While the chairs were supposed to be more collaborative, and therefore they have taken root in some of the places, some places it is withered away. So there is a difference in their approaches there. I think by and large, we have not done too badly given the resources that we have.
Thank you. Suresh, you want to say anything?
No.
Well, I won't pretend to summarize everything that was discussed. I think we had a very rich discussion and wonderful comments by our esteemed panelists. I will say one thing. I learned in the ICCR a lot about diplomacy. And if you're dealing with classical musicians and dancers, I think you have learned all the lessons you need to learn about diplomacy. So. But when it comes to defining culture, if Pami sort of threw the challenge at me, I thought of the saying, fools rush in where angels fear to tread. I will not dare to do it. But I leave you with the image that is found in the book, which I found very touching. Pami has described culture, Indian culture, like the golden temple in Amritsar. It's a shrine which has doors open in all directions. I think there was a consensus amongst our panelists that this is what India stands for. Openness, pluralism, and everybody agrees to that. Thank you, Raghavan, for organizing this. Would you like to say anything?
On behalf of the Council, I take this opportunity to extend our gratitude to Ambassador Paramjit Sahai for enlightening us about the book and his views on cultural diplomacy. Further, we are grateful to Ambassador Lalit Mansingh for chairing the session and our esteemed panelists for sharing their invaluable thoughts on the book. Last but not the least, I thank the audience for their valuable participation. I now request you all to join us in the foyer for tea. Thank you.